Last Sunday morning, a number of us here heard a beautiful message from Glenn Blossom, and I said to the Lord, that's too good to miss. I must share it on Friday evening. So for those of you who were there, it may sound the same or it may not, because we sort of treat things in a different way. But he said to us that we are to love not the world. From the reading that I shared with you earlier in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15. And this is what the Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. That's terribly difficult, isn't it? I mean, we're to live in the world, but we're not to love it. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. The world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. That's great, but what does it mean? And how can I apply that to my daily life? I don't live in church, I live in the world. I'm active in the world. I'm working with people in the world. How does this apply to me? What does it really mean for each Christian believer? And what does it mean to any one of you here tonight who's never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Because you're in this too. First of all, I want to say what it does mean to be part of the kingdom of God, as against, contrasted with being the world. And I want to literally just compare and contrast. So the whole human race, every one of us here, is either in one group or the other. You're either in the kingdom of God or you're in this world. And there's no route in between. There's no room for the don't knows. The Bible is quite specific, and if you like to say that, it's dogmatic. You're either in the kingdom or in the world. Well, what's the difference? First of all, the children of the kingdom of God are godly and righteous and alive to God. On the other hand, those who are not in the kingdom but are part of the world, they're the ungodly. They're the unrighteous. The Bible says they're the children of disobedience. And they are dead in trespasses and sins. If as you sit here tonight, you're not in Jesus Christ because you've never accepted him as your Savior, the message I have from the Word of God is, you are spiritually dead. You're dead. You're dead in your trespasses and sins, and you will remain like that until you come to the foot of the cross, confess that you're a sinner, and receive Jesus as your Savior. But otherwise, you're dead in your trespasses and sins. And the end that you will have after this life is eternal death. Or you say, Richard, I believe in a God of love. Then you'd better believe in Jesus Christ too. For he's the Savior. And no man comes to the Father but by Jesus. Secondly, those who are in the kingdom live in the light because God is light. In the first chapter of that letter of John, it says in 1 John and chapter 1, verse 5, this then is the message we have heard of him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Well, that means that God is totally pure. He cannot have sin in his presence. And then it goes on in verse 7 and says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanseth us from all sin. We live in fellowship together because we're in fellowship with God. That's the kingdom. It's interesting, isn't it? If somebody moves away from their Lord, you don't see them in the fellowship. They stop coming. And you say, well, where's so-and-so? Well, they're not walking in the light. They're back in the darkness and they've left the fellowship. But what about the children of the kingdom? The Bible says they live in sin, and therefore they live in darkness. That same chapter in verse 6 it says, if we say that we have fellowship with God and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ, the Bible says you're in spiritual darkness tonight, and therefore in sin. Thirdly, we find that those in the kingdom live in the fullness of a God consciousness through Jesus Christ. We know that wherever we go and whatever we're doing, the Lord our God is with us because He's everywhere present, and we acknowledge that. But those who live in the world, they live without hope. And when they come to the end of their lives, there's nothing. That's why it's so desperate to go into a secular nursing home. You feel it, the hopelessness, the helplessness. We've got to the end of our lives and there's nothing. And the Bible says that's right. There is nothing except in Jesus. For the children of the kingdom, we are in a counterculture against the world. And that's why some of you find, as you go through life, you keep coming up against the world and they come up against you, and it's not easy to live. Romans chapter 6 underlines this. In verse 13, the Bible says this: neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead. You're alive from the dead. You see, that's why we could sing those songs of praise tonight, because we're alive. I live because He lives. And in that living, I rejoice and I praise. And our friend in the balcony read that psalm of praise. That's right. But for those who are in the world, if you're in the world, you live by the world system. You live by the world's culture, and that is controlled by the devil. It's not controlled by man, it's controlled by Satan. And he has dominion over them, and sin has dominion over them. That same chapter, Romans 16 and the next verse, says this: for sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are under the law, not under the law, but under grace. Now, if you're a Christian believer here tonight, sin does not dominate you. But if you're living outside Jesus Christ, sin controls you. You're not free. You don't do what you want to do. You do what sin within you dictates you should do. And then we also find that for those who are in the kingdom, we're a holy nation, we're a royal priesthood, we are characterized by holiness. You say, what is that? It means that God has taken us in Jesus Christ and He separated us from it for Himself. Separated us to be His. Holy people. For those of you who are still in the world, the Bible says the world is under the prince of the power of the air. And it's characterized by sin, by self, by greed, by chaos, by destruction. And how many times you come in on a Friday night? In fact, one of our counselors asked for prayer tonight because they'd had such a dreadful time before they came. That's the world. It's the chaos and it's the destruction. It's trying to divide and destroy. It's dividing marriages. It's dividing families. It's destroying people. That is Satan. In the kingdom, we are to live in the rest of God. Not in anxiety, not rushing, striving, but resting. Went to see a friend today, another minister. I got there 2 minutes before he did. He has a comfortable study. I found a nice chair, sat down, relaxed. He came and said, "Hey, Richard, you look so rested." I said, "Good, I've only given 8 addresses this week." And bless him, that Episcopalian looked at me twice. But I was resting in the Lord. That's the only way I can work. The moment I get into the act and start getting busy, I can't handle it. And nor can you. If you live in the world, there is no rest. There's never any peace, because the world is out of step with and fellowship with the Creator. You see, unless you're right with your Creator, you're not going to be right in life. And you're only right with your Creator through Jesus Christ. 1 John 1 and verse 3 says this: that which we've seen and heard, we declare we unto you, that ye may also have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with Jesus Christ. That's the fellowship of the kingdom. The world is the opposite. Do you see the contrast? Do you get this picture? Let me move on. What does the Bible mean by this term, world? I read it to you from 1 John 2, verse 15, in the first part. It says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. We mustn't love the world, but we're told to live in it. Lord, how can we do this? What are you saying to us? Well, first of all, what the world is not for a Christian believer is vital to understand. It is not that we shouldn't love sinners. We are told by our Master to love our neighbors ourselves. So as we move in the world, our love has to flow out to all people, whoever they are. That's the first thing. Secondly, it is not that we should not love the earth. God created the earth and put everything in it. And it's there for our good. We see God in creation. We also see what sin has done to creation. The Bible tells us that when God made all things, He made everything perfect. When man sinned, it affected every part of creation. And the Bible says in Romans that the whole creation groaned for the return of Jesus to put things right again. Also, it does not mean that we should not have things. There are some groups that believe that they have the truth of Jesus Christ, and they don't have cars, and they don't have this, and they don't have that. That's not what the Bible says. Jesus said, I have come that ye might have life, and have it more abundantly. And if you're going to sit around reading your Bible every leisure moment, I don't think you've got life. I think you need to be set free. He wants you to have life. He wants you to have it abundantly. And He wants you to live it in the world. Well, all right. How can I get this difference and this division? What makes me different? Well, John underlines the danger here for the Christian believer in the world. It's in the next verse. Listen to it. And then see if you understand it. All that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of God. Ah, now we're getting down to the problem. What does the Bible mean here? The lusts of the flesh, immorality, overeating, giving in to addictions, whatever they may be. Or, put it this way, judging everything by your appetites of the flesh. People do that. They judge everything by their appetites. And that comes out of situational ethics to some extent. Oh, if it feels good, do it. The Bible says that's lust. The second thing it says is lust of the eyes. I believe that's fantasies of the mind. Be careful. There are psychiatrists teaching us today that we should fantasize. Now listen to Jesus instead of the psychiatrist for a minute. Matthew 6 and verse Matthew 5, 27. He says this. And he's speaking. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her, hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Jesus says, you can fantasize and you sin. That is lust of the eyes. Listen to Jesus and not to the world. So many of us as Christian believers, instead of reading the Word of God, we read this good book and this bestseller, and we don't know what God said. God said, that is not of me. The lust of the eyes is not of the Father. Be careful. We're so influenced by the world, and yet we live in the kingdom. If you're a person whatever you see, you must acquire it. You've got a problem with the lust of the eyes. It may even be for your home. It may be for your life. You see it, I've got to have it, I've got to have it. That's lust. You need help. You need healing. You need to be forgiven of your sins. What about the pride of life? It's called life's empty pride. What does that mean? A person who all the time is trying to project to other people that they are going to possess this and possess that, and they're always talking about the greatness of the things they're going to have and the person they're going to be, and that's not of the kingdom. It's the great I am magnified. Boasting of things they don't possess. Empty pride, says the Bible. But also, the Christian believer must recognize what the world is. The world is a system. It's a system of ideas. It's a system of ethics. It's a system of philosophy. You learn it in high school. You're taught it in university and college. You read it in the books. You read it in the newspapers. It's a philosophy. And right now, in this nation, it's humanism. And humanism is anti-God. And if you're moving into this humanistic thinking, you're moving out of the kingdom back into the world. The world is a system governed, controlled, not by God, but by Satan. Therefore, we must be very careful of the fruit of that system that we see. You see, that system is finite. You have come to Jesus Christ and you've become infinite, and therefore you can't move in that system. It's the devil. God is eternal and God's made us eternal. And the problem with the system of the world is it controls people. And because you've given your life to Jesus Christ, you must be controlled by no one but Him. He's the one. He is Lord. He's my Lord. Then let Him control your life as you live amongst the system of this world. Thirdly, what's my attitude to be in the world? And what's my behavior to be in it? If I'm living in the world, in this world system, and I belong to the kingdom of God, how should I behave? First of all, we live by different ideas. To start at the beginning, we believe in creation, not evolution, because God said it. We find that the ideas that Jesus taught are the opposite of the things the world teaches. That's why it's so difficult. If you're a highly trained person and you come to Jesus Christ, there's so much you've got to unlearn. Listen, Jesus speaks again. In Matthew 5, verses 43 and 44, he says, "You've heard that it's been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemy, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." Some of you wives, you're being very badly treated by your husbands, for which there's no excuse. Jesus says, pray for them. Pray for them. Love them. That's Jesus. The world says that's crazy. That'll never work. Jesus says it always works. Because love is eternal, because God is love. Secondly, we find we should handle the world differently because we live in the kingdom. Many of us are beginning to realize rather slowly that the natural resources that God has given us can run out. Water. Maybe oil, although I think they've got a lot more than they tell us. Food. I watch some of you sometime. You weren't brought up in Europe during the war. because you'd eat the plate too if you had been. But we as believers can't send back plates in a restaurant nearly full while people in other parts of the world starve to death and say, oh yes, we are Christians. You are. And that's how you act. Also, we must handle people differently. We can't tread on others. God is still their creator, as he's ours. We must also stop manipulating people. That's true in families. You have no right to manipulate anyone else in the family. They are people for whom Jesus died, just as you're an individual for whom Jesus died. And yet one of the biggest problems we see in families is manipulation. You can't do that in business if you belong to Jesus. You can't do that in your church if you're in the kingdom. Oh, you'll meet the manipulators, of course you will, but you have an authority in Jesus to deal with them. Also, we must have a new view of life and people. Man has a dignity in God. Man is made by God, and men are not expendable if we belong in the kingdom. That terrible statement. Well, a war always kills a few off. Can't say that. Well, those famines just get rid of... Those are people for whom Jesus died. That's the Christian view. That's the kingdom. We cannot indulge in some of the activities of the world. You cannot be involved in anything that is occult. Deuteronomy 18 and verse 9 says this, Thou shalt not learn to do after the abomination of those nations. There shall not be found with thee anyone who is a fortune teller, a soothsayer, a magician, a witch, a hypnotist, a consulter with familiar spirits, a medium, a spirit guide, a psychic, a medium who consults the dead, for all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. That's it. The moment you go in that direction to seek answers, you're saying to God, I don't need you. And God says, that's an abomination to me. And Christians are getting involved in occult practices. And the cults, back to what J.R. said last week, things like the way, any teaching where Jesus Christ is not Lord, get away from it, don't have anything to do with it, leave it alone. Jesus must be Lord. And I must be separated by God and for God away from these things. My life is His. My body is His. And in my life, I begin to hunger and thirst after righteousness. And you've got men and women who worship with you in church, and they're getting into everything that they shouldn't touch. And I want you to know the things you should and shouldn't do if you're part of the kingdom. How do I live in the world and be separate from it? First of all, let me speak to those of you who are here and unmarried. You must marry within the kingdom. The Bible says, be not unequally yoked with unbelievers. Oh, you say, Richard, I love him. I love her. All I can tell you is, Jesus who dwells in you does not want to be made one with that person who's part of the world system. Oh, Richard, when we're married, I'll bring them to the Lord. No, you won't. Because light cannot fellowship with darkness. It can't. And what's true of the marriage is true for business. If you're a partner with someone else and you're moving in the things of Jesus Christ and that person's part of the world system, there's going to be a break, there's going to be a split, You can't last forever. It's going to finish. Also, we must not be world controlled. I shared with you some months ago, Romans 12, verse 2. Let me read it to you again. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Get the new ideas from the Bible. Get the teaching of Jesus to become part of your life. If something in the world is against Scripture, you can't touch it. Or, if there's something you find that you've got a dependence on, it's wrong. You are only dependent on Jesus. Well, what do you mean, Richard? It could be alcohol. It could be drugs. Anything that you go into to find reality that's not Jesus Christ is wrong for you. You're part of the kingdom. Your dependence is on Him. He's Lord. Oh, you say, Richard, I have to take my tablets to get peace. No, you don't. You have to get closer to Jesus. And you need more time in His Word. And He'll give you a peace that's beyond understanding. You don't need the tablets. You've just become dependent on them. If I can't let go of something and I am dependent on it like that, I'm addicted to it. And that's wrong for me as a Christian. And some of you struggle over tobacco. Others of you don't want to stop smoking. That's different. But if you're struggling to stop and don't, you've got a problem. You're addicted. And you should be addicted to Jesus. You see, once I've come into the kingdom, I'm made to be totally dependent on my Lord. Jesus is to control. And from that, by His Holy Spirit, He's going to work through me. And the more I studied these thoughts that I've shared with you, the world and the kingdom, to live in the kingdom and be part of the world, I've got to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. The moment you accept Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes into you. But let me ask you something. Does the Holy Spirit control you? Have you got on your knees and said, Lord, I just ask you to possess me by your Holy Spirit? Because when you do that, you're going to be able to handle the world system, although you're part of the kingdom. But you've got to be Spirit-led. You've got to be Spirit-controlled. You've got to be Spirit-dominated. And when the Holy Spirit gets such a possession of you, the supernatural things that God is doing amongst us in your life will become the natural. Because that's the way life is in the Spirit. And when Jesus died on the cross for you, He died so that your life could be totally dominated by His Spirit. And you as a Christian believer and part of the kingdom, you'll never be satisfied, you'll never be fulfilled until the Holy Spirit comes in and takes control. You won't. Let's pray. Jesus, I just thank you that you said that you come to give us life and to give it more abundantly. And I pray for every brother and sister in this church that they may find that abundant life in Jesus Christ, enjoying you and enjoying life because you've given it to us. And we thank you for that, and we thank you for the salvation you've given us, and we thank you that we've inherited eternal life, and it's all because of you. And I pray for anyone in this sanctuary who's never found you as Savior, speak to them. Lord, may they be saved from eternal death.